It's me. Leave a message at the beep.
Hey, buddy. It's me. Hey, I just had to call you because I'm at a rest stop, and apparently there's a... there's a payphone here. A payphone? I mean, what is that? I mean, right? Yeah. I mean, that's pretty weird, right? It's weird. Okay, man. Well, you know, call me back. Bye.
So we're doing another react here. This is from Postmodern Jukebox, who does, you know, swing kind
I've
of interpretations.
I've seen their stuff. Yeah, they do really good covers.
The guy over on the piano there is the guy in charge. I think his name's Scott, I think. And he does the arrangements and finds the talent,
wow.
Puts it all together.
What a beautiful microphone.
Mm-hmm. That's what I was thinking, too. See, my first impression was, she's so hot, there's no way she can sing. And I was mistaken.
That's kind of being big up there, Brian.
Well, us fours and fives need to do something to compensate. That's why people are like, God, you're so funny. How'd you get so funny? It was easy. I was very unliked as a child. And I had to do something.
I was fugly. I was pug-ugly. God damn, that kid's ugly. Put him in a corner. Look at the size of that boy's cranium. I'm about tired of that bug flying around.
Just great.
See, this is the problem with music videos I haven't seen before, mm-hmm. is I'll watch them.
Yeah.
You know, we could do some reaction. Well, you know what you should do is get some old 80s video from MTV Styles.
Oh, sure.
We could have a blast with that. I'd come down here. We could make that a whole new thing.
Yeah.
I don't think that's been done.
Take on Me? My God.
Oh, man.
I don't even need to see it. I could just, you know, from memory.
That's an awesome. I really like the way they did the
Family Guy version.
Family Guy. Oh, God. That was funny as hell.
Chris, where were you?
I have no idea.
Yeah, that was fantastic. One of my favorite songs, actually, of all time. Of all time.
Yes? Oh, that song. It's the inflections. You never know when he's done with a sentence.
It could end.
If I do it, it's whispers.
Check out my new movie where I play another psycho mad scientist, that guy. And
that
Kevin,
would be so surprising.
Yeah, I turn a guy into a cat.
Yeah, that's like,
what the hell is the actor's name that gets turned into a cat?
Oh, that'd be Jeff Goldblum, the one that flies?
No, what movie are you the fuck talking about?
The Fly.
No, he never flew in that movie, and this bug is going to kill me.
No, I think he did fly, where someone turns into a cat.
It's a new movie. It just came out in theaters not too long ago. It's
Is it called The Cat?
No. Nine Lives, I think is what it's called.
Ah, you know what? I saw that's at the $2 theater. But
is it already at the $2 theater? Bam.
Yeah.
That feels
Boy,
good.
There was something we went and saw that was just got at the $2 theater, and it was crazy because it came out in like November or something, and it just now got to it. Boy, what was it? Maybe Civil War? I don't remember, but something that just took ages.
Really?
Yeah, so look at this, though. Amazing.
What a voice. Absolute voice. I love the orchestra. I love it.
Yeah.
It's awesome.
And the videos, they just do single camera, nothing fancy, focus on the music.
There were many times that I wanted to change a song in karaoke and make it my own.
Mm-hmm.
And... well, there was one time, and I remember getting kicked out of that bar and being pummeled by four bouncers. And as I'm getting pummeled, I look over in the parking lot, and there's the cops watching the four bouncers beat the fuck out of me.
That's great.
Because I went a little profanity-esque with the song.
Well, that's why you don't go to church bars.
Oh, wow. Okay, I was going to say, where do those exist? And then I thought, no, Salt Lake City.
Maybe.
I really like her top.
Yeah, she does have a good high range.
10 points for Gryffindor. And that woman in the yellow top.
Did I tell you that I actually did an interview with Alan Rickman about 10 years ago for the podcast?
Really?
Yeah.
You never told me that.
Yeah, it's a short interview, but I'll show it to you later. It's really good. It was
all right.
It was really exciting to have an opportunity.
I love Alan Rickman. Just recently, I was watching Die Hard, but he was Hans Gruber. Hold on, I love this part. That was fantastic.
Yeah, great stuff. And Postmodern Jukebox has hundreds of songs up.
I've seen a lot of their stuff. That's one of those bands that can actually do a cover, do it their own way, and make
Absolutely.
It something new and original.
Absolutely.
You know?
And that's the problem I have with a lot of covers is they're not original. They don't bring anything new to it. There's a lot on YouTube where you'll see these young kids where they're playing, I'm playing all the parts, look at me, and they play all the parts. But the song they do is so true to the original, it's like, no, I'll just listen to the original.
There's so many ways that people are doing that to kind of catch people's eye on YouTube and get attention. We were talking about Take On Me. I believe it's been redone. One by was a punk band that I really enjoyed. Another is, I think, is by Saving Ferris.
Save Ferris, yeah. That's the one I was thinking of.
Yeah,
Boy, that's a great album. It's only 30 minutes long or something, but, it's ska. It goes fast. All right, so that was reacting to Dream On by Postmodern.
More talking, but we enjoyed it. I really enjoyed the singing. Beautiful voice. Love the orchestra. Always have.
Mm-hmm.
Add a piano in there, a classic piano. Man, it can be top-notch. So.
All right.
I'll give that a thumbs up. Two of those. Look at those. They just came out of nowhere. Jamie.
So, Ty, yes. This is something really exciting. I mentioned this in another segment that's probably in the future, but about 10 years ago, before he passed away, I had an opportunity to interview Alan Rickman for what I knew someday would become my podcast.
Right on.
And what's neat is, I don't know if you know this about me, but I've aged really well. So 10 years ago, I not only looked just like this, but I wore this shirt.
That is awesome.
It's well made. I only break it out for special occasions. So, you know, it lasts. It's like the Santa suit. You know, wear it once a year, you get 30 years out of it. So we're going to do a segment called Chatting with a Pro. Chatting with a Pro. So, Mr. Rickman, thank you for coming on the podcast.
Thank you, Brian, for having me here this evening.
Yeah, so I understand you're in that new movie, Gary Porter, the swollen dong. What is it? What's the name of the movie? With the wizard boy?
Oh, Harry Potter.
Oh, I don't know where I got Gary Porter. My AOL dial-up isn't working great today, so... I have
problems with that at times, too. So, Brian, how are you today?
I'm great. If you need some CDs for your AOL, I can hook you up. Because I've got, right now I have about 300 of them. So, it's great.
No, I'm fine.
You're fine?
I have Napster.
Oh, good.
I'm getting a lot of music off of there. Just downloaded Judas Priest.
Hellbent. Yeah.
For leather.
It's amazing. You can download a song in like 30 minutes.
It's incredible, the technology, the way it works.
And the files are huge. They're like 3 megabytes. So, Harry Potter, what did you most like about spending a decade wasting your acting training making movies with ham-fisted children?
Believe it or not, I enjoyed my time on the set of Harry Potter.
Did you?
Yes, children running amok. Different director every movie.
Really?
Yes.
I did not know that.
Yes.
I have to be honest, I haven't seen any of them, but only because I don't give a shit.
I can understand where you're coming from on that, Brian, but you know, I got to play somewhat of a bad guy, a bad wizard. My name is Severus Snape.
Mm-hmm. And is it true that, you know, like with action movies, how you have to learn stage combat and all that, is it true that you actually learned black magic?
I don't want to answer that, Brian, on the mic. No, I didn't learn black magic at all.
Well, that seems good. So who was the bad guy again in those movies? What was his name?
If I recall... He who shall not be named, Voldemort.
See, if you're breaking a non-disclosure agreement, I think that's pretty unprofessional. Because if you're not supposed to say it, I mean, I don't want to tell you how to do your job.
I think you can blank this out if you'd like.
I will.
Beep it out and it should be fine.
I will blank out you saying Voldemort.
That's fine.
And I'll bleep that out too, because that's just silly.
Well, it's like... Hans Gruber would say, ho, ho, ho.
Now, is it true that he was the Kraken? Or am I confusing that with something else?
What the hell are you talking about?
Okay, I must be thinking of a movie, a different movie. What movie did you most hate making in your career?
Believe it or not, I did not enjoy working on Dogma.
Really?
That's
strange because it
no,
was...
No, don't get me wrong. I enjoyed the movie. It was fantastic. I just didn't like working on the movie at the time.
Well, I understand that you're running out of minutes. You've got, what...
On my card, I've probably only got 3 or 4 minutes left.
Okay. So I'm gonna go ahead and break it there, but I do want to say that you were really great in that one thing.
I was really great in that one thing, and believe it or not, I was great in more than one thing.
Okay, guys, so, I made this post on Reddit, last night, and apparently it got a lot of traction, so I have to tell the story here. So this is a story of incredible revenge. I lived in an apartment and moved in. You know, the price seemed really attractive for the size of the place, and it seemed like, you know, a good deal. You know, big place, plenty of rooms. You know, it was actually a 4-bedroom apartment, a washer and dryer, garage. The price was really amazing. And then I moved in. Well, just before I moved in, I found out that the washer and dryer actually cost an extra $150. And I said, well, that's fine. I've got my own. I can bring those. No. It is ours or none. So if you'd like our washer and dryer, it's an extra $150. Well, the price is, gosh, it's creeping up there, but it's fine. As long as I get the free garage. They go, no, the free garage is it's a drawing. It's not for new residents. It's a drawing. It's a drawing. And I said, well, who wins the drawing? Well, we can't disclose that. Oh my God. Nobody wins the garage. So now I'm up $250 over what I thought the apartment was going to be. You know what? It's fine. I have to move. The time is right. Let's do it. So let's sign the 1-year contract. No, it's a 6-month. I said, well, let's do a 1-year. Nope. 6-month. That's what we do. Well, that's pretty weird, but you know what? It's fine. I have to move. So I'm already here. Fine. 6 months. Well, 6 months go by and the rent jumps from $1,100 plus $150 plus $100. So $1,350. It jumps up to $1,550. Or if you'd like to go month to month, it'll be $1,750. And I'm like, wait a minute. This doesn't make any sense. Well, it turns out they get a big tax break for renting to low-income people. People in a very narrow window of low income, which I happened to be in at the time. Now, they are not under any obligation to rent at low rents. They just have to rent to people who fit that income description, regardless of what they end up paying. Now, unlike other apartments, the water and sewer was not included. And they had this incredibly arbitrary way of, they said, no, we've got, you know, electronic sensors. We come by and we read the meters electronically from outside the building. Well, 1 month we were gone for 3 weeks out of the month, and our water bill was the same as if we'd been there all 4 weeks. So, I mean, that's plainly bullshit. So as we're getting ready to move out, we find out that they have a reputation for not giving back deposits. Now, the deposit was like, I don't know, $500, $700, something like that. A reasonable amount. I mean, a very reasonable amount. But it's not as reasonable when you consider you're never going to get it back. Well, I contacted them in advance and I said, listen, guys, I know you have a reputation for not giving back deposits. I'm going to preempt this. I'm going to nip this right in the bud. I am going to not just do the walkthrough, but I'm going to take pictures and video of every square inch of the apartment when I move out. And I did. The bathrooms, the fridge, the carpet, the blinds, every square inch of that place had pictures and video upon my walkout. So 2 weeks go by and I get a notice saying, your deposit is not being refunded. You actually owe us $170, but I tell you what, sign here and we'll let it slide. So I called them up and I said, no, guys, listen. What the hell? The apartment is move-in ready. It is spotless. The carpets have been steam cleaned. It is immaculate. And he said, no. So I went back and forth with them on this for like, 2 weeks. And I kept you know, inching up the rhetoric to suggest to them that perhaps raping me on this would not be the best course of action. But they, you know, they don't care. They've got, you know, it's a checklist. Rape the tenant, take his money, done. You know, you just got to do that. So, I kept ramping it up, and then it finally came down to them saying, okay, I tell you what, of your $700, $500, whatever deposit, we'll give you back $100. To which I said, nope, nope, no. You give me back the whole deposit, or, you know, we get ugly. And this was at a time when I was making a pretty substantial amount of money. And this wasn't about the $100 or the $300 or the $500. It wasn't about the money. It was about the principle. It was about punishing bastards. And buddy, I was ready to do it. And oh my, did I. So I said, okay, you send me whatever you want to send me. But I'm telling you right now, it is not acceptable. And we'll go from there. Well, I let it be known to other tenants in the apartment, the busybodies, the same people who had let me know damn well that I would never get my deposit back, that a new website had been created to elucidate the policies of this apartment. And since I was working in search engine optimization at the time, if you were to Google that apartment complex, my site was the number one result, and their site was the number four result. So anybody looking to find out anything about them would find me first, and them maybe later, if ever. Oh, the owner caught wind of this, and he called me personally. And he tried to goad me into extorting him. Well, I tell you what, how about I give you back the $300 and you delete the website and we call it even? Oh no, my friend. That was the deal a week ago. You forced me to do all this work. What are you talking about? No, the deal now is, you make it right, not just for me, but to some higher order. Well, he wasn't interested in that. And again, he tried to say repeatedly, you know, what will it take to make you take down this site? Now, every single day, a new article was publishing, explaining the ways in which they were lying, evil bastards. Now, all of these were legit. They were fully defensible. All of the, you know, it was things like, on the website, it said, you can rent out, you know, you can use the cabana for parties. No, you can't. No, you absolutely fucking cannot. No, you can. Well, we've got a movie theater. You can use that. No, that's not true. Well, we've got, you know, all these amenities. No, you don't. No, you don't. So I get a call from the owner, you know, and he's like, oh, come on, you've got to take this down. You're killing me. I'm like, buddy, you're killing you. I'm just telling people the ways in which you're killing yourself. He's like, okay, I'm going to send you the money. Take down the site. I said, well, you do what you think you need to do. You do what you think is right. And I'll do what I think is right. He's like, you're not taking down the site, are you? I'm like, of course not. Of course not. You sent me a bill for $700 of cleaning on an apartment that is absolutely clean. Can I see a receipt? Sure. He sends me a receipt. It's handwritten. It doesn't have a business name on it. he's charging like $90. He's paying $90 an hour for cleaning. Buddy, get the fuck real. Are you kidding me? I go, dude, $90 an hour for what? 10 hours to clean a already flawlessly clean apartment. You've seen the picture. You've seen the video. I mean, they're, I gave them to you. No. Fuck no. You have scammed hundreds of people per year. This ain't going away. So, if you'd like to consider another tactic to make this what would have been a $300 issue go away, by all means, do it. So he says, you know what? Listen, I know you're really good with web stuff. Why don't you come into my office? Let's have a chat. I would like to hire you to do some web promotion for my business. So I was like, absolutely. So I went in and he said, okay, well, I noticed, you know, there are some bad reviews on different websites about my property. I said, well, yeah, your property's shit. Your managers are systemically fucking evil. So yeah, I mean, that's, he goes, well, I tell you what, why don't you go onto these sites and see what you can do to curry favor and I'll give you $1,000. I said, I will do that. He said, okay, will you take down the site? And I said, buddy, we cannot make A contingent upon B. He said, okay, fair enough. So again, this is over $300. He goes, okay, first of all, I'm going to refund that $300 because I agree it was wrong. It was wrong of me. Yeah, you goddamn right it was. So I go onto these sites. I make some mitigating statements. I submit an invoice. And he says, well, you know what? I noticed the site is still up. I notice you're still kind of, you know, not in my pocket. I said, buddy, hey, you gave me back the money you already friggin' owed me. This $1,000 has nothing to do with that. So, you know, just do the right thing. He's okay, fair enough. Here's your check. So I went, I cashed it, boom. Now that $300 that was always mine, plus $1,000 that he paid me for to, I guess, be less of an asshole. Well, what I did with that is I said, okay, fair enough. I am no longer going to publish new stories about the degree to which an asshole you are. He goes, great. I don't like your language or your tone of voice, but I accept it. I accept it. It's fine. I said, great. Okay, so we're done. He goes, yeah, we're done. So you got the 300 and the 1,000? Yeah, I did. Are you gonna take down the website? I said, no, the fuck I'm not. That was never the deal, and you're welcome, because, I mean, get the fuck real, man. That was the deal before you ripped me off. So that site, you know, it stayed up for a year, and at the end of the year, it died. And, you know, in that time, I don't know what he lost, but I hope it was a lot, because Heatherwood Mill Creek Apartments are just the fucking worst. Slumlords, man. Well, you know what? It's the end of the podcast. It's the end of the broadcast. It's the end of the week. Here we are, We broke the half hour mark, so that's great. Guys, I want to give a big, fat, crazy shout out to Greg the Hero, who does all my backing music and my segment bumpers, and a much, much smaller shout out to Kevin McLeod of Incompetech.com for the intro and outro music. Kevin, you're still my bro. You're still my bro. Never met you, never talked to you. Still love you. You're a good guy. I don't care what any of those smart-ass judges say. You're my dude. No, it's fine. It's fine. I'm more likely to get a response out of that than I have ever been over the last 63 podcasts of saying kind things. But, you know, it's... Who cares? Who cares? So, you know, follow me around the web, you smart ass. You think you're so smart? You think you're so smart? You haven't shared me. You haven't given me love. You haven't liked me. Write a review on iTunes, you dumb bastard. I dare you to, but only if you make it a nice one because, oh man, I just... I'm dying here, man. Anyway, so yeah, do that. Do that. I, you know, whatever amounts of doubling or tripling of dogs daring thee, that is the amount of dares that I bestow upon ye. No, follow me around the web, glossynews.com/podcast. There you'll find links to iTunes, Libsyn, Twitter, Facebook, and even probably Reddit, just because I can't update the page, even though nobody responds to me on Reddit, even though I'm on Reddit constantly. It's like my biggest addiction. What is wrong with you people? It is the best site in the world. Interact. Come on. You can do it. I know you can. Closing thought. And you know what? You know what? You dumb sons of bitches. There is always a closing thought. I swear to God. Criminy. And I don't even know what criminy is, but I believe in it more than Christ. No, that's not the point. The point is, if autonomous cars become a reality in the next 5 to 10 years, it means that women in Saudi Arabia may never drive. It means they can go straight from stuck in their home until a brother or cousin takes them to the market. Skip all that driving nonsense. Just hop in a Uber that doesn't have a driver. Just get in a Johnny cab. Go to the market. You'll be fine. I mean, the robots are taking over, and my concern is not just that they're taking our jobs. Yes, they will take our jobs. My problem is that they're also dating our women. And if you don't believe me, go to any sex shop and look at the robots available to take your place. Oh my God. They're like 4.5 feet long. You could make a shish kebab out of your wife with these things. It's really upsetting, and I don't know what to do about it. All right, guys. See you next, Sunday for the regulars, next Monday for the rest, and you know what? Do me a favor, would you? Would you? Could you? Take care of yourselves. Take care of each other. I love you guys. Talk to you soon.